I grew up here not knowing there was anybody named Jim Crow. When my relatives died, the white people put on their suits and came over to our house. I thought black and white people helped each other.
Before the turn of the 20th century was this family that didn't look like any other family, because it was two single women and an African-American girl. And the whole community accepted it.
It's the best place you could live, possibly live. And I've lived there all my life, except when I was in service.
Those white women didn't just treat my grandmother like she was a servant. They treated her like she was family.
I know she loved them. She really did. That was her whole conversation, Miss Maggie, Miss Sally this, Miss Maggie, Miss Sally that. They really was good to her.
They were viewed as kind of odd, but in a good way. They were very firm, strong women, really didn't seem to care too much what other people thought about them, and they were going to do what they felt was right.
They was always generous. I think because they didn't have any children, I think they just needed somebody to care for. My grandmama would tell me all the time, all she had to do was say, Miss Maggie, I needed this. She needed a dress, she had it. A pair of stockings, a pair of shoes. The next day she'd have it.
Our grandfather was Richard A. Hudson. We had a farm, and we had like six or so tenant farmers, which were all black. And all my playmates and friends were black.
You wouldn't need it, did you?
No, everybody picked cotton.
But we never have any racial problems.
No.
At all on the farm.
So when we have family reunions, we have them for the church because so much of the family goes to that church. So when they extended an invitation, they came to this church.
I found out later that actually Maggie and Sally Ross lived in a big house next door to that church. That was ground zero for the story that made Marvin the kind of community that it is. And that was the heart of Marvin.
I learned that my mom family inherited the land from Sally and Maggie Ross. People won't believe that them white women gave black people that much land.
People were coming in who had nothing to do with this land being bequeathed and trying to change the minds of people who knew the Ross sisters by relationship and by reputation.
The case was set for the spring of 1921. Judge J. Biss Ray presiding. Jury selection took until nearly midnight with over 100 people interviewed. You might say, why 100 people? Well, you had to be okay with black people inheriting white land.
Especially back then, people came forth and told the truth, and the truth transcended color.
J.G. Parks, manager of the Belk store in Waxhaw, had seen that equality when Maggie and Mittie shopped together. So when he testified, he said, but for their difference in color, I would have thought they were equals.
12 white men on a jury in the Union County Courthouse upheld that will, and the family inherited the land.